Hey guys, this is Patrick from STH. Today, we're going to take a look at the Fungible F1 DPU and how it creates an absolutely crazy storage array in the Fungible FS1600 that's being announced pretty much alongside this video. Now, those that follow STH know that I have been on a DPU kick for several months. And specifically, we had a video a little while ago called, you know, what is a DPU and kind of explaining what they even are. And we go into why a DPU is different than a CPU, a GPU, a SmartNIC, or any of those types of devices. But today, we're going to go beyond just explaining, and we're actually going to demonstrate some of the differences. With the launch of the FS1600, we get to see why this really matters. Now, this system actually has two fungible DPUs. It has its own DDR4 memory. It has NVDIMMs. There are 24 NVMe SSDs. There are a total of 12 usable 100 gigabit per second networking ports. Oh my gosh. And there is not a single PCIe or standard PCIe slot or NIC in this device. Now, you're not going to see like traditional ARM or x86 CPUs in the system really driving the software. Instead, it's all basically running on the DPU. And because of that, they're able to hit something like 10 million IOPs and over 37 gigabytes per second from a single 2U device. And later in this video, we're really going to show how we started about 2 million IOPs and about 8 gigabytes per second per server. And Fungible is able to actually linearly or pretty close to linearly scale their performance with the number of client servers and number of devices they have. So I was on a pre-briefing with Fungible and we were going over the FS1600 announcement a couple weeks ago. And I was like, hey guys, this is kind of cool and stuff, but what would be more impactful is, well, what if we actually went and saw the box? I mean, there's something tangible about actually getting to see hardware, see how it works, see what the results are. That's kind of more tangible than just seeing things in slideware or in a press release. It's one thing to see an animation, but it's another one to actually get to go and see it in a conference room or in a rack. And since this is STH, if there's going to be a big old storage server that gets released or a new solution gets released, of course we're going to want to go get hands-on with it. Luckily, the Fungible team agreed, and so I grabbed my camera, jumped in the car, ran down Central Expressway, and went over to the Fungible building. Just a fun fact here, the Fungible DPU actually uses MIPS cores, so it's a MIPS, not an ARM or an x86-based processor. And the Fungible office is actually in the old MIPS Silicon Valley building, so it's kind of fun that, you know, it's actually like the old MIPS building, that's where they are. And while I was there, we basically did three main things. So the first thing that we did was I got to do a little bit of an interview with Pradeep, the CEO. Now, Pradeep is actually well-known in the Valley because he is a former co-founder and ex-CTO of Juniper Networks, which everybody knows. We also got to see the product itself and got a tour from Benny, the VP of product over at Fungible. And so he gave us a little tour of the solution. And then we got a demo that Benny also showed us in terms of seeing the performance of the solution. They're really loud, so we didn't really want to run one in a conference room and disrupt everybody that was working. And giving you a little preview, once you install this Fungible solution, it's like turning on an NVMe over fabric fire hose of data going to your servers. Now, as a complete shameless plug, while I'm over there, I'm also wearing my fancy STH COVID mask as a fashion accessory. I'm also wearing a STH shirt today, both of which you can find on our Teespring store that we're going to link in the description. A little bit of a shameless plug, but you got to do it, right? So let's start with our interview with Pradeep, the CEO of Fungible. And just as a quick fun fact, two little housekeeping notes. First, I'm actually sitting off camera asking these questions. I'm re-recording these after the fact, so that way we don't have to be on camera at the same time and you don't have to hear my muzzled voice through the wonderful STH branded COVID mask. Second, as kind of a fun one, we actually got some weird interference on site about every 28 seconds or so on the lavalier mics, which kind of destroyed some of our audio that we were capturing with the lavalier mics that you're going to see. And so we had to go to our backup audio source. So that is a good storage lesson learned right there, which is always bring a backup, because if we didn't have the backup, we would have been totally screwed. But instead, we had the backup mics and, well, we got audio. So that's good. That also meant it was a really good opportunity for me to re-record the questions after the fact. So hey, Pradeep, would you mind just introducing yourself real quick?
Hi there. I am Pradeep Sindhu, CEO and co-founder of Fungible.
Awesome. So Pradeep, why do we need a DPU anyway?
The reason we need a DPU is that the combination of technology and applications are at a point where the existing building blocks are no longer sufficient to address the infrastructure needs of data centers. We have two problems. First of all, Moore's law is flattening, which means that gains that we were getting from improvements in CMOS are no longer coming. And so general purpose microprocessors, which used to be sufficient for handling all workloads, are no longer sufficient. Secondly, we've had an explosion of data, and we are in fact in a data-centric era, and this calls for inventing a new kind of element which we call the data processing unit or the fungible DPU. The fungible DPU addresses two of the basic problems that exist in today's data center infrastructure. Problem number one is that server nodes cannot interact efficiently with each other. The second problem is that there is a class of computations that we call data-centric that cannot run efficiently on general-purpose CPUs. General-purpose CPUs were invented a long time ago, but they don't work efficiently for handling these data-centric computations. But the DPU is designed specifically to address these two basic problems.
There are a lot of storage solutions out there, but what's different about Fungible's DPU approach?
The two problems that I just mentioned are clearly understood by hyperscalers. And so the first attempt by the industry to address these problems has been to invent what they call smart NICs. And smart NICs are nothing more than a set of general purpose CPUs, typically ARM, combined with Ethernet interfaces and PCI Express interfaces. This does not even begin to address the two problems I talked about. So what we did at Fungible was to systemically address these problems by inventing a new kind of architecture. It is very easy for people to put labels, but it is very difficult to invent a new kind of architecture. This happens only once every two or three decades. So the architecture of the DPU consists of a set of general purpose CPUs, which are intimately combined with a set of specific accelerators to address these two functions or these two problems. And this combination, where these CPUs can interact with these accelerators at very, very fine grains, is the thing that distinguishes the DPU from anything else that exists today. And it is the only way we believe that these problems, the two fundamental problems that I mentioned, can be addressed.
Okay, but why is Fungible's DPU the right answer to the storage industry's needs?
There are two answers to this question. The first one is that traditionally, the data path and the control and management planes of storage have historically been combined and addressed by a single general purpose CPU. These things are typically called storage controllers. Now, as long as the performance of general purpose CPUs was improving, this approach was fine. The problem, as we pointed out, is that the performance of I/O devices, particularly storage devices and the network, has been increasing so much faster than the performance of CPUs that this approach no longer is viable. So what you have to do is you have to split the problem into addressing the control plane of storage and the data plane of storage. Well, the DPU turns out to be the perfect device for handling the data path of storage. And this is indeed what our fungible storage cluster has done. The data path of storage is vehemently a data-centric problem. And recall that the DPU is designed to address specifically data-centric problems.
Hey, Pradeep, you mentioned separating the data and control planes. Would you mind telling me a little bit more about that?
You know, the reason that the data plane and the control plane of storage needs to be separated is that given today's performance, reliability, and security requirements, as well as the requirements for agility, the only way to address them is, in fact, to separate these two into two different engines. You may recall that this separation happened first for networking some 25 years ago by Juniper Networks, and that revolutionized the networking industry. Prior to that, both the control plane and the data plane of networking used to be addressed by general purpose CPUs. And the networking industry hit this problem, as I said, a quarter century before the storage industry did. All we're doing is recognizing the fundamentals of the problem and actually splitting the overall work required for storage into these two pieces so that we can have the combination of agility, security, performance, and reliability, as well as the economics, to address the overall problem of storage in data centers.
Thanks, Pradeep. And this is actually a really fun interview for me because, you know, I grew up around a whole generation of folks like Pradeep in the Silicon Valley that look at storage and modern clustered storage really as a data movement problem. There's a whole series of engineers in the Valley that look at modern clustered storage and scale out storage as like, okay, well, you have some data on some disks and you got to move that data out into various network clients and you have to have some kind of quality service. Oh, this sounds like a networking problem. And that's how they approach it. It's completely different than how you would see someone that grew up with a storage background taking a look at a clustered storage solution. And so it's just kind of fun to get to see that perspective. Now, as part of Fungible's overall design, they have something called True Fabric, because of course, if you're going to come from a networking background, you need to have some kind of fabric. And so we're not going to cover that in this video. Instead, I'm going to refer you to the STH main site. We have some links in the description where we talk more in depth about the actual DPU SoC, but also about True Fabric. So if you want to check that out, go check it out. Instead, today, because we're on site and get to go look at physical boxes, we're going to go take a look at the FS1600. And to do that, we have Benny, who's going to show us around. So Benny, take it away.
Hi everyone, my name is Benny Siman-Tov. I'm the Vice President of Product and Business Development for Fungible. I wanted to introduce to you today our FS1600 storage node, which is part of the Fungible storage cluster. We'll start with the front. It's a 19-inch 2RU high and hosts 24 NVMe U.2 SSDs. So this is the back of the FS1600. What you see here is the two power supplies, and we have 10 by 100 ports connected to each DPU, out of which we really need to use only four ports for each DPU to maximize the SSD throughput. There is a 10 gig management port, and we have console USB and BMC control port. So looking at the FS1600 from above, what you see is the two DPU that we have powering the system. The DPUs are under those heatsinks. They are pretty much replacing the x86 in standard storage solutions. And they're connected to the optical interfaces on one side. And as you can see, there is no NIC card in the system because the DPU is implementing that function. DPU also implement the storage stack and the security stack on top of the networking stack. Each DPU has two memory types connected to it. We have RDIMMs connected to it. And then we have an NVDIMM that's connected to a supercap. The NVDIMM is used pretty much to acknowledge write at a much higher performance. The system has two redundant power supply. Each one of them can power the entire system, and they're hot pluggable. So each DPU is connected directly to 12 SSDs on the front. So two DPUs, each one of them connected to 12. Those are the flash from where the DPU boots. We also have a BMC on the card. And we have this small COMI card that we used in the early days to do some bring up and development, but it will be coming out soon. So this system really is a CPU-less storage, everything running on the DPU. As you can see, we have five fans. They're redundant, they're hot swappable, and can be serviced in the field.
That was an absolutely awesome hardware overview. I'm just going to reiterate a couple points because I want to make sure that our viewers and our readers understand the gravity of what we just saw. So first off, there are 24 NVMe drives up front, which is kind of standard in this industry. But then you have this giant motherboard PCB type of thing, and there are two DPUs. Now, each DPU has its own memory, has its own NVDIMMs. There are no NICs in the systems because the DPU controls the networking. These DPUs also have things like HBM memory to provide high memory bandwidth that you don't necessarily see in normal CPUs today. In the future, that may change, but today you don't really see that. And so they are offering something that's completely different, and you don't need a CPU. They run their own OSs. This is something that is completely traditional CPU-less, and instead you have these DPUs that are solely focused on moving data from the NVMe SSDs and putting it onto the fabric while handling all the services that you need, whether that's quality of service, compression, encryption, you name it. That's kind of what these things are there for. In some ways, this is really like having two different servers on the same motherboard PCB in the system, but it really just kind of just shows how scalable and how interesting this solution can be. So you might be looking at the hardware and be like, okay, well, I guess that's cool, but like, how does it perform? Because that's the ultimate test, isn't it? And so what the Fungible Array does is it has its own controller, but it presents itself as an NVMe over fabric solution to servers. And so a server, it's actually very easy to integrate these things because you just set these things up like, you know, it's an NVMe over fabric target, and it's very easy to integrate on the server side because of that. So I asked Benny if he could give us a quick demo in terms of, you know, how do you actually set this up on a server? How do you, you know, how does it perform? And so we're going to take a look at one, a little bit of the setup, but then also, I mean, the setup's going to be go by in like a blink of an eye, but then also we're going to look at, you know, what does the scaling look like when you have like maybe one server, and we're going to see over 2 million IOPS and over 8 gigabytes per second there. But then also we're going to go take a look at what happens when you have a cluster of say 5 servers all hitting this fungible storage nodes. And so Benny, why don't you take it away?
Okay, hi everyone. So this is the Composer UI interface, or and specifically this is a dashboard. This is where we present all the data we collect from the cluster. So you could see how much capacity there is, how much IOP the system is using, what the bandwidth and what the latency. And then we can get into more and more granularity about DPU utilization and how the physical storage is being allocated. Now, we also show that in form of graphs. And so you see IOPS graph and how the system been behaving and then the bandwidth. And then the latency and so on. So what we will do next now, we will show you how you go and create a volume. And we can create two type of volumes. We can create durable volume and a raw volume. And then we will assign them to a server and we'll show performance and scalability. So we're creating now a volume. Okay, it's a raw volume, which means there is no protection. Okay, the volume was successfully created. Now we're going to create another volume, which is a durable volume in this case. We allocate capacity and we're going to make it erasure coding, and the configuration will support it 4.2. We can enable compression or not. In this case, same with encryption. In this case, we will enable compression. Okay, volume was created. So here is the volume that we just created. Now we're going to go and allow access to it to a specific server we have ready in our environment. So access was now granted to the server. And we have to copy that command and execute it on the server to attach the volume. Now that we attach the volume, we can see that the server now sees the volume. And so now we'll do the same for the durable volume. Here, the durable volume we created, we're going to allow access to it, and we will execute that NVMe connect command on the same server. So now that server will see both volume. One is a durable volume, which is a 4.2, and one which is a raw volume. Next, what we want to show is how we run some performance tests on those volumes and show you how the system is going to collect that data and show it. We're going to run a tool called FIO that's doing read and write into those SSDs, into those volumes. Okay, so the tool is running and you can see now that we already are capturing on our dashboard the performance, the IOPS performance and the bandwidth performance. And our bandwidth is about 3.4 gigabyte per second, and we're achieving about 890 kilo IOPS for that volume. Now we have connected the second volume, and we're running the test now on sending, writing, and reading data from two volumes. And as you can see, the IOPS scale pretty much linearly. So we're now achieving 1.7 million IOPS. So that's some of the benefits of the fungible system, where the DPU is able to scale quite linearly the performance, both on IOPS and bandwidth. So next we will now connect four volumes and run the FIO test across those four volumes. And as you will see, the performance will continue to scale linearly. Okay, so as you can see in the dashboard, we're reaching 2.2 million IOPS. We actually reached the maximum capacity of the server. This is why you don't see more IOPS or more bandwidth. But it just showed that we can actually extract the entire 2.2 million IOPS from a single server. Okay, so next we're going to show you, we showed you until now scalability of volume within a server. Now we're going to show you scalability of
of servers connected to multiple volumes in the fungible storage cluster. And in this case, we'll run the FAO benchmarks across five servers we have in our environment. Each one of them gonna run the 2 million or so of IOPs, and we would expect to get a total of about 10 million IOPs supported by the fungible storage cluster. So the dashboard is collecting the telemetry from the different nodes and calculating the data. It takes a few seconds to get the most updated numbers. So as you can see, we're getting in the vicinity of a 10 million IOPS, 37 gigabyte per second. It just shows that there is linear scalability. We actually, in other tests, were able to go all the way to 8 nodes and extract the full 15 million IOPS from the system.
First off, I just want to say thank you to the Fungible team for having me. This is the kind of coverage that I absolutely love to do on STH. Many STH readers or those on YouTube have tried different solutions, especially NVMeoF Fabric solutions, and found limitations on traditional servers. Linus has a video where he just tried taking an off-the-shelf Epic server and put some random software on there and saw really bad performance. And the reason for that is that you actually do need very tight system integration, and you need these kind of unique hardware solutions that can take advantage of what we really get, which is a new era of performance compared to what we had in the old SATA SAS days. Now, the Fungible DPU solution is a really systems-based approach to delivering a whole lot of performance. And so it's not really using off-the-shelf standard parts, but it has some really cool performance and really cool features. This is exactly why I wanted to show off the DPU, what it can do, and why I think it is a new type of processor that should sit alongside and at the same level as a CPU, GPU, or other type of accelerator that we normally think of. And hey, if you made it this far, why don't you click on subscribe, turn on those notifications so you can see whenever we come out with new videos. You can always check out the STH main site. We have new content every single day. Thanks for watching and have an awesome day.